Years ago, your independence wasn't allowed. Only good for cooking and cleaning up the house. Only known for being a housewife wearing gowns. Went from dependent to the most independent girl around. Your discipline with your diligence, I respect that. Equal rights for the sexes, we all accept that. Random guys with her number, she might expect that. But if she's not on this grind, she might reject that. It takes a boss to date a boss lady. Got what it takes to date a boss baby. Yeah, bro, sexy, that's a boss lady. Know how to carry a sex, you're a boss lady. Do whatever to succeed, you're a boss lady. You gotta practice what you preach, you're a boss lady. You gotta get it on your own if you're a boss lady. You gotta always hold your own if you're a boss lady. Respect you cause you respect yourself. Remain humble and proceed to collect that wealth. Make your own money so you could invest yourself. Don't let nobody hold you back, you could progress yourself. Stay strong through the ups and the downs, the smiles and the frowns, helping others progress. Make it more for their talents, from the musicians to the models. Since I met you, I viewed you as a leader to be followed for those planets.
Well, thank you everyone for tuning in to Boss Lady News. I'm having a great day today. I hope you all are also having a great day. We've got a wonderful show for you. We're going to be speaking with an old friend. Amanda's going to be coming back on. And we know her from the Raw Art event that happened downtown. And the Raw Art event actually happens every year, so you guys look out for it. And then we're going to be speaking with a friend of hers that is another New England artist. And I know Stacy. And Stacy Padula is going to be talking about her book series. And you guys can find out more about where to get them. Hint, hint, you can find them in any of the Barnes & Nobles. And last but not least, you guys will get a chance to see some footage from the Erika Chanel fashion show. Yes, the Fame fashion show that many of you models were in. You guys did a wonderful job. I had a great time doing backstage management, and my daughter was there running around in the back. Some of you models that were there got a chance to meet her. Last but not least, I've got a special guest for you as the last 5-minute performance, and you'll find out about their intro earlier in the first half of the show. With no further ado, let's go ahead and talk about some news. Let's get into it. Well, some of the topics that I wanted to bring up, I'm not actually going to bring up, but there will be one specifically that I'm going to talk about that happened just recently in the New England area. But before we do, I'd like to discuss my new gift. Yes, I have the Apple Watch, and many of you out there are trying to maybe get it or find out more about it, but it's quite a toy. It's quite an expensive toy. We all know that technology is moving in wonderful different ways, and we've gone backwards a little bit. You know, this kind of reminds me of Inspector Gadget. It also reminds me of some of those technology movies that we used to watch back in the day where you can talk into your wrist, get your phone calls from your watch, and do much more. Check your messages, check your emails, you can check your time. And more importantly, the purpose for Apple actually creating the watch was to check your movement. So there are quite a few activity apps that are attached to your watch. So it's really meant to help you get fit and get healthy, as well as taking your hands off of the cell phone and looking into people's eyes and talking to people again, because you can just check your messages right from your phone. You can just check your messages right from your watch. But let's not forget, physical interaction and talking with people is always more important and more special than just texting or emailing or calling someone. That's in technology. You guys find out about all the new technology things that are out there. There's also an app for opening your doors to your house. There's an app for turning on the heat and electricity in your house, and there's also an app to track your children, which I feel is very important. This new app was designed to track your children because a lot of missing persons, family members, have actually encouraged the technology world to help out with these missing children, and the best way to do that is to be able to track your children, much like we do with buses already, much like we do with transportation. You can track your Uber. And hopefully this will help to alleviate the situation with missing children's reports and missing individuals. I'd like to discuss what happened in the Roslindale area. It was a little bit closer to the Dedham area. There was a young man shot and killed by police officers. He was assumed to be a terrorist. They were tracking his Facebook messages in his Facebook movement. They were actually tracking his computer code and some of the sites that he had been going to. In case you all don't know, the government, the police, and the Federal Bureau are able to track any of the sites that you go to. We all know this. This is not crazy information. I just think as individuals, we feel as if these intrusive actions are not happening. I wanted to tell you about a brief story. I actually have my cell phone bill paid automatically. That way I don't forget to pay my cell phone bill. And I got a notice on my watch letting me know that my cell phone bill payment was about to be taken out of the account. However, something kind of perturbed me quite a bit. There was an ad attached to that notice. So that means T-Mobile actually sold my information and allowed a company to attach an ad to the notification that comes to me to let me know that a payment's going to be taken out of my bank. I don't know how you guys feel about that potentially happening to you, but I'd like to know. Feel free to contact me on any of my social media or shoot me an email. Give me your name. How can I connect with you? And let me know, what do you think about intrusive technology? We allow a lot of apps into our lives. We allow a lot of allowances as far as your notifications, as far as your location, as far as photos to be shared. Is it a little too much that's happening these days? Is it too intrusive? I'd like to hear from you. Let me know what you think about that. All right. You can also go to BossLadyNews.com now and find out more information. You can find out about a lot of the community outreach that I'm doing. Also, you can find out more about BNN, Boston Neighborhood Network, which is where the television production is recorded. And it's available in other cities. With no further ado, we are going to cut to a brief PSA. And when we come back, you guys, we're going to talk with Amanda Smith.
Here is my handle and here is my spell.
When I get all steamed up, then I shout.
Tip me over and pour me out. Oh.
The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life.
Cheers.
Take time to be a dad today.
The average text takes your eyes off the road for nearly 5 seconds.
Thank you for staying tuned to Boss Lady News. And now we're going to get a chance to talk with an old guest, yes, Amanda Lamoureux Smith. Why don't you come on out here, Amanda?
Hi.
How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Good.
Good to see you.
It's so good to see you. Have a seat. I am so excited to have you back on.
I'm excited to be here.
And I want to know, what have you been up to lately? Last time we met was the first time we had ever met.
Correct.
Well, the first time we met was at the Raw Boston event.
Yes.
And then you came on to the show. What have you been up to?
So I've been busy with my artwork. Mm-hmm. I've been doing some marketing consulting on the side.
Nice.
And I'm taking some communication classes.
Oh, yay.
Yeah.
How do you feel about those communication classes?
I never took them, but... I think it's essential. I think in your business life, in your professional life, it's important to know how to communicate on all different levels, so...
Yeah. And with marketing, you're also working more on what marketing yourself and your art.
Absolutely.
Tell me about what's going on with the artwork. I'm very excited because your art is so unique.
Thank you.
And it's so very personal to you. It's very you.
Yes, it is.
So tell me about first what got you into artwork, which some of my guests already know, mm-hmm. but what got you into pursuing your dream as an artist?
So I just had a notebook that I would write down a lot of thoughts mm-hmm. and a lot of quotes that would inspire me. Mm-hmm. And so I kept that very private. And it wasn't until I had the opportunity at RAW to showcase my art, and it went from doing that in a notebook to calling myself an artist, which for the show, you know, you had to do. Mm-hmm. So that took me some time to get acclimated saying that. And then I brought the notebook with me, which is kind of how you found me at Raw, which is a very personal notebook that mm-hmm. I brought because as an artist, I think it's important to represent where your art comes from and what that means to you. And although it was very personal and a little vulnerable to have that there, I wanted people to know this is where my artwork comes from and this is how it came to be. So.
Yeah. And again, just so you guys know, the way that me and Amanda kind of got a chance to meet was I was walking through the Raw Art event that was being held at Royale downtown.
Correct.
And there was a notebook sitting on the table. So I was kind of being nosy. You know, I'm like, what's going on here? So I start flipping through the notebook thinking nobody's paying attention. And then Amanda came walking over and she introduced herself. And in an environment of so many people that were already calling themselves artists.
Correct.
And then you just said you had to get used to calling yourself an artist. How did you feel stepping into the shoes?
Intimidating. Because that was my first art show, I felt I was excited and very grateful for the opportunity. But to throw yourself out there and to have to promote yourself as an artist, especially when none of my friends or anybody around me knew that I was doing that. So it was, I mean, as an artist now, you know? So
yeah.
it was exciting, but it was definitely scary.
Yes, I
But I'm
imagine.
So thankful for the opportunity, and I'm so happy that I had the courage to go through with it.
Yeah. And where are people going to be able to see some of this artwork that's going on?
So my next show is July 26th. Mm-hmm. It's Merge Arts Boston at Venue from 7 p.m. to 12 a.m.
Nice.
July 26th. So.
And what are we kind of going to be expecting from the artwork this time?
So I think I'm transitioning my style a little bit. So I'll have some of my old stuff, and it'll be exciting to see how I grow as an artist and how my style changes over time.
Nice. I'm excited. I know I'm going to make sure I'm there. So
yes,
I can just
I would love that.
Kind of immerse myself in art. There's not enough art. Well, there's a lot of art happening in Boston,
mm-hmm.
but it's almost still that fear of getting yourself out there, that
Absolutely.
Fear of really immersing yourself in pushing your artwork. And, you know, it's great that these art events are happening.
Absolutely, and especially with abstract art, because that's not everyone's tastes.
Mm-hmm.
So to have it up there and to have it on display, you're susceptible to critics and to supporters alike. So luckily I've had, you know, a lot of supporters, but you always have that fear of it not being someone's taste, and that's understandable. It's a different type of art, so.
Yeah. You're your own taste, and that's what
yes,
matters. Because
absolutely.
Once you believe in yourself, then it's that much easier for others to believe in
I
you.
I agree.
And I, like I said, I need a piece. I need
yes.
a piece that I can keep on set.
We have to
for
talk
me.
Later because I have to figure out your color scheme.
Yes.
Yes.
We're going to cut to a brief PSA, but
okay.
before we go away, give everybody your information, and then we're going to take a look at some artwork you brought today.
Sure. So my Instagram is Amanda L.A. Smith, and that's where you can see the different types of artwork that I will have at the show, and July 26th at Venue from 7 to 12 p.m. a.m.
Nice. We will be right back. We're going to take a look at some of Amanda's work.
Great.
I would first like to let all the young people know that what got me started was reading. Let all the young people know that what got me started is reading.
great outside.
We both love the outdoors.
So shiny!
That's not a flower. We both love geology.
Oh, look!
An igneous one.
That's not a rock.
And she knows a lot about wildlife.
A labradoodle!
That's not a dog.
Hanging out has been kind of fun.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of kids in foster care will take you just as you are.
Hello, everyone. You are tuned into Boss Lady News. And we're here with Amanda, and we are talking about your artwork now. Mm-hmm. Again, we met Amanda, or I met Amanda. You guys got a chance to meet her also over at the Raw Art event, and you've got another event coming up in July.
July 26th.
July 26th. You guys make sure that you are there. And let's talk about this artwork.
Sure.
I see the difference. There's not as much color in here, but there's a lot of feeling. It feels like a lot of feeling.
So the main function for this piece is the interconnectedness between math, speech, and language, mm-hmm. And how everything boils down to a number. And so the function of language and speech and thought. So on the back of this, you can see the frame here, but on the back of here, the name of this is Frame of Reference. Mm-hmm. So, of course, you'd normally spell frame differently, but I wanted to put the function or the aim of this piece is to give you a frame of reference. So that's why there is a frame on here.
Nice.
So it's just a lot of thoughts and a lot of connections between numbers and speech and history.
And when we were during our break, you were kind of mentioning how you'd gone over it a couple of times and to make it a little bit deeper.
Yeah,
darker.
Well, as I was doing it, my thoughts would connect with each other. So I ran out of space. So I would write over the thoughts and over the previous foundation of the original piece. So that's how it came to. And then, of course, with the thoughts comes, you know, the design and the angles and things like that. And, you know, it was one of those things that was a brainstorming session. It kind of gives you a piece of how my brain works.
Yeah. And when you start with your artwork, what happens? What makes you sit down and start going into doing your artwork? What kind of clicks for you?
Moments of clarity. When I hear something or I see something on TV or in a conversation that gives me a moment of clarity from something that I previously thought, or a new connection, like a pathway in the brain that connects then I put it down on paper and it kind of sparks creativity and different colors and different thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, some of my pieces take a long time. Some of them are very quick. And I think that's the key is knowing when to stop. Which is still a work in progress.
I can see that you kind of keep going. I was looking at a few things that are on here. You've got heritage, ancestral awareness, answers, and then you've got the triple A's going on mm-hmm. over here. And I do see some equal signs and equations. So a lot of your artwork is something that people, you really have to look at. You have to get immersed in.
Correct.
And look at a lot of the detail and a lot of the feelings that are going on in here.
Mm-hmm.
What does this say right over here?
So what would be corrected within the same category of the main point of the message if it were to keep in our same current standards? So this is just kind of a continuation of thoughts
mm-hmm.
and how, you know, as we move forward with history, what we would correct or what we would connect to get to the next level. And, you know, what are the consequences of staying in the same mindset and the same way of handling things?
Wow. And that's deep in itself. We know that there's a lot going on in the world right now.
Correct.
And a lot of people should maybe take a moment to sit down and think about your thoughts and think about how you feel about some of the things going on out there. I'm sure it would help to relieve some pain that's inside of some people's hearts, and it also allows you to open up.
Correct.
And might become an artiste, much like Amanda. And here, I wanted to keep this flipped because you'd explained to me before your signature.
Yeah.
And I love the signature. I wanted
Thank
you guys
you.
To get a shot of this. And this piece is called Pills and Potions.
Yes.
Now explain to everybody about this footprint.
So the name actually came from a Nicki Minaj song, I'll explain where that came from on the front. So my footprint, for my first art show, I had stepped back in my own paint, and this was in the midst of me not knowing how I was going to sign my artwork. So I had stepped back in my palette, and I got scared because it was wet, so I stepped back again, and one of my pieces happened to be flipped over, so I stepped directly in the middle. And because it was the paint that I used to paint the photo, instantly it was like, oh, well, there you go, there's my signature. So that's what I've been doing ever since, and people really seem to respond to that. And
yes.
So it's a little messy because every time I have to step in the paint that I was using, but I don't mind.
Yeah, I mean, I love it because it kind of reminds me, you guys know I'm a mom, so it kind of reminds me of birth. You know, most parents may have that footprint, that
baby's
footprint.
Yeah, that's the first piece of artwork that anybody ever makes, right?
Yeah, I love it.
Yeah.
I love the idea. I love the concept, and it just came together very well. Now, tell me about this piece here.
So the Pills and Potions took me to a place of prescription drugs. And in this day and age, when everyone is prescribed something, you go in with an ailment and you're bombarded with these different prescriptions. And I've just seen over time how people their head can get very cloudy.
Mm-hmm.
So these are actually shower tiles, mm-hmm. But it's just to showcase kind of how the chaos will go on and your priorities and your frame of mind will be off. And so it's just to reflect, you know, the day and age with prescription drugs and how, you know, there's a more holistic way to go about it because, yeah, things can get a little crazy on prescription drugs.
I mean, it's absolutely true. Many of my family and friends, you guys know, I hate taking pills. I hate taking any kind of medication, allergy mm-hmm. medication, headaches. I'll go into a dark room and tell mm-hmm. everybody to leave me alone before I have to take something. But, I mean, at the end of the day, this is how you feel when something starts to bother you
mm-hmm.
and then you have to take medication and it starts to clear up and
but create other problems.
It creates
the stagnation
problems.
So the splattered paint is, you know, your body's digesting this and things are going through it and it might temporarily fix something but cause
wow.
other problems.
Okay. And how are you starting to, or how are you marketing your artwork?
So I've created an Instagram photo and it's purely my artwork, so you can see how an artwork piece starts and how it starts to build and develop over time. And again, I have the show coming up on July 26th at Venue in Boston.
Yes.
So that's exciting.
And it's important to market your stuff, not just on your social media, but get out to events.
Correct.
And do some personal, physical, you know, one-on-one mm-hmm. marketing with your customers. But you also brought a friend here.
Correct.
That you're helping to do some marketing
yes.
with. And this is Stacy. How are you? It's
Hello.
Very nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Amanda, let me know how you and Stacy know each other.
So we actually worked together a long time ago and we got reconnected through a mutual friend who thought that we would really get along. This is when I was starting my artwork and she let me know that Stacy had become an author and we really hit it off and found out that it would make sense for me to help her market her books because she's a very busy lady.
And you have quite a few books actually. We're
yes.
going to take a moment and we will be talking about them. But I love the correlation in art altogether because being an author is your own thoughts and that's your artwork as well.
Yes.
Yeah. So we're going to cut to a brief PSA and when we come back, we're going to find out some more about Stacy. I know Amanda's got to go.
Yes.
You guys make sure that you are at that event. It's going, again, where can they go?
July 26th at Venue in Boston. It's Emerge Arts in Boston.
Nice. All right, we'll be right back.
Years ago, your independence wasn't allowed. Only good for cooking and cleaning up the house. Only known for being a housewife wearing gowns. Went from dependent to the most independent girl around.
Don't worry. 74 people were picked before me in the NFL draft.
To fight childhood obesity, United Way and the NFL are helping kids play at least 60 minutes a day.
Okay, time for the team obstacle course.
Yay!
What this place needs is more healthy kids. To get involved or donate, go to unitedway.org/play60.
Now I get
a
single ember from a wildfire can travel over a mile. That ember can ignite and destroy your home or community. You can't control where that ember will land, only what happens before it does. Visit fireadapted.org to learn how you can help protect your community from wildfires.
Thank you for staying tuned to Boss Lady News. You guys know you can see it every Friday at 6 p.m. Just in case you didn't get a chance to catch the news earlier in the show, these are some of the topics that we had. And now we're going to go ahead and talk with Stacy Padula. Amanda, thank you for inviting your friend on. Another of Boston or New England's authors. I'm very excited to have you here.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here.
Are you originally from Boston?
I grew up on the South Shore. I grew up in Pembroke, and then I lived in Boston for college.
Yes. Was it like an extreme life change coming from Pembroke into Boston?
Not really. I have always been drawn towards the city, so I had ventured here a lot, you know, growing up and as a teen. So I was excited to come here.
Yeah.
I love Boston. I love just the spirit of the city and how it's such a sports town and there's so much history. So.
The sports can get crazy. Yeah. I'm still getting used to, and I've been here forever, still getting used to the fanatics. But it's always fun to have people who are from outside of the state coming. But, you know, coming from outside of the city into the city is sometimes a change for people, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. And when you were younger, did you ever desire to become an author? Was being educated, was that something that you saw yourself doing, being a writer?
I wrote my first book when I was 6.
Wow.
Yeah, I learned some words in school, and then I came home and wrote my parents a book, and then I just never stopped. And it was just something that I've always enjoyed doing. And I read a lot as, you know, as a small child, and I was very eager to learn about what to expect in high school socially. So I read a lot of books that were about high school. And then when I entered high school, it was like a whirlwind because it was nothing like the books I had read.
Yeah.
And it was actually in high school when I started writing this book series because I felt that the books I had read sort of had done a disservice. And I wanted kids to have a realistic book so that they could be prepared for what you really face there, because there's a lot of social issues and, you know, just a lot of things that sometimes, you know, your parents don't want to talk about with you, you know, but it's like I wanted to know, so I'm sure there are a lot of other kids out there that wanted to know, or just when you're going through just the sea of craze that is, you know, adolescence, just to like have another perspective on things. So
an outside perspective.
Yeah.
I actually was a little sister to the Big Brother Big Sister program.
Oh, okay.
And I've got a 14-year-old now watching you. And the times have changed drastically.
Yeah.
And I'm sure, you know, from your parents, our parents, to the parents that we will become, it's very different for the adolescent and the teenagers going into their 20s. I like that you have a series. So you've got this book here, and this is a part of a trilogy, correct?
Yeah, it's the Montgomery Lake High book series, and then there are a couple books that are sort of sequels to the series that focus on just individual characters and their stories.
Okay. Now, tell me more about the Montgomery Lake series.
Montgomery Lake High book series follows about 14 different characters, and they're all in different paths, and they all have, you know, their own battles that they're fighting. And ultimately, my goal with the series, which I actually discovered after I graduated college, I found the books and then I started adding in and editing them, adding in like life lessons that I had learned through the years. They were first published 2010 is when this book came out.
So wait a minute, let's go back for a second. When did you start with these?
So I wrote the first draft of When Darkness Tries to Hide and The Right Person when I was in high school.
Wow.
Yeah.
Congratulations, number one.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah. I mean, it's amazing to be a young person and desire to even want to take this route. So definitely congratulations at such a young age to be writing these.
Oh, well, thank you. Yeah. Thank you. And I ended up, I actually went to college for architecture and interior design. And then after I graduated, I found the drafts that I had written. And I was like, I can't believe I knew what this stuff was when I was in high school. I can't believe that was all going on. Mm-hmm. Like, I think this could help some kids, because I was also working with the youth, been a youth group leader. I now, for my profession, I run a private education company. So I do life coaching and academic tutoring. I help kids apply to college and just find their own paths. And I just really felt that these books could maybe shed some light on some topics. So mm-hmm. I added to them, and then I wrote additional ones to kind of link them together and just forward the series. So
wow. So you've got this series here.
Yep.
I'm going to give you this. And who are some of the characters that you lead into your next set of books with?
Jason Davids is one of my main characters in a couple of these books. Mm-hmm. And he is a very deep character. He's been influenced by his older brothers and just got into partying at a young age. And he has so much talent and so much wisdom, but like no direction.
Okay.
So the aftermath follows his path as he's trying to navigate just through finding his way and trying to find his way out of some things that addiction, stuff like that, that
wow.
have just encroached upon his life. My books deal a lot with substance abuse and mm-hmm. recovery and just trying to find positive path when you have so many influences pulling you in a
and
different
direction.
And
that's very real. That's very yeah. real in high school. You've got young people dealing with sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
Yeah.
You really
yeah.
do. In the music, today's music is not the best music for them to be listening to. You guys have heard me say that multiple times.
Yeah.
But I like that you're dealing with some real life stories here.
Yeah. And, you know, the books are meant to just help the kids, I don't know, just see a different perspective and maybe to try to find a way out of something that they've maybe been entangled in, because the series covers so many different people. There's so many different personalities, and I feel like someone will relate when they read. They'll relate with somebody in
exactly.
the story.
Exactly.
You know?
So. And the other character.
Yeah. So that this one chronologically would come after mm-hmm. the aftermath, mm-hmm. and it also comes after this book if someone was to read the series.
Okay.
So this is the last book that I've released, and that focuses on Andy, who's a main character in a couple of the books as well.
Okay.
And it's sort of just his journey. This one's more of a thriller and a mystery. It's written a very different way than the other books, and it deals with some spiritual things as well, which that's also a message that's entwined throughout the books too.
And that's important in today's yeah. world. All of the different religions, all of the different denominations out there, there's an essence. There's a kind heart.
Mm-hmm.
There's a love one another, love your neighbor as you would yourself.
Yeah.
And I understand that your spirituality is what also helped you want to create a lot of these books and write these stories.
Yes, actually. So I was working in Boston for T.R.O. Jung Brannon. I was on the interior design team.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd been there for about 2 years. And I just wasn't feeling fulfilled. It was like this nagging in my heart. And finally one day I just prayed and I was like, God, like, I know you created me to do something and I know this isn't it, but you have to show me what to do. I'll do anything. I'll go back to school. I'll go on the mission field. I'll write books. I'll do whatever it is. Please show me.
Mm-hmm.
And ultimately a bunch of, you know, things sort of fell into place and I ended up taking a leave from that position and just praying about what I was meant to do. And all of a sudden, one day I was talking with a friend and they were just telling me a story about someone they know and they mentioned a tutor. And it was like the word just stood out to me. And I'm mm-hmm. like, tutoring, I love one-on-one conversations. I love math. I love English. I love working with the youth. Like, how does someone become a tutor? So I started looking into it. And I wanted to find another job where I would also have time to write and something that would revolve around the youth, because mm-hmm. that's where my passion is. And I looked into it and I really couldn't find much out about how to really become a tutor if you're leaving like the architecture field.
Exactly.
And after a couple months, I prayed one day and I was like, God, if this is really you laying on my heart that you want me to become a tutor, you have got to show me who to talk to, because I have looked everywhere and I don't really know where you want me to go.
Mm-hmm.
And that night I was out to dinner with coworkers from my architect firm, and at the time they thought I was coming back, that I was just taking a family leave because my stepdad was really sick with pancreatic cancer. So they didn't know that I was thinking of changing careers.
Okay.
And my friend got a phone call and she's like, I'm sorry, I need to take this. My friend is on bed rest. She has a complicated pregnancy. I just want to make sure everything's okay. She lives in Virginia. So she takes the call and after she hangs up, she's like, oh, she's like, that was my friend Jamie. She just amazes me. She's down in Virginia getting her PhD. She runs this really successful tutoring company. And I'm like,
wow.
What? And I was like, oh, but she lives in Virginia.
My hair's just stood up for you.
Yeah, because it was just that day that I had prayed, show me who to talk to. And
wow.
Some like tutoring company, and they were like, yeah, so, because, you know, they thought I was coming back to the architect firm. And I was like, oh, but she's in Virginia. And they're like, yeah, but her company's here. She's originally from here. I couldn't believe it. So they put me in touch with her. Mm-hmm. And I remember feeling so underqualified for the position. I went on the website, and it was all these licensed teachers that had gone to, like, Harvard for education. And I was like, okay, well, I'm going to, you know, submit this, and we'll see what happens. And she ended up calling me and saying, you know, oh, if you could get some more experience, I see that you've worked with the youth before, but why don't we see if this is really, you know, the road that you want to go down, get some more experience, and then, you know, call me back. I'm like, okay. Seemed like the door was shutting. And then 2 days later, she called me. And she's,
wow.
Yeah, and she's like, you know what? I've been in business for 7 years, and all my clients have been in the Metro West, and you live on the South Shore. Out of the clear blue, I'm getting calls from people from Kingston, Braintree, the Cape, that one or two. She's like, I am taking that as a sign from God.
Wow.
She's like, I need you to come in for an interview.
Wow.
And yeah.
We're going to cut to a brief PSA. And okay. When we come back, I actually want to take a few more minutes with you.
Okay.
And just talk about that entrepreneurial spirit.
Okay.
That really drove you to what you're doing.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
We'll be right back.
Hey, Hard, what's this?
That's my resignation letter.
You're resigning.
Why? Because you're constantly ignoring me. You're half as active as you used to be, and you get stuff like this.
You've been putting me under a lot of pressure lately.
That's why I'm ready to quit.
I forgot. I'll do better. Please, don't quit on me.
Okay. But remember, it's not what you say. It's what you do.
Listen to your heart. Don't let it quit on you.
Let's go for a walk.
Uncontrolled high blood pressure could lead to a stroke, heart attack, or death. Get yours to a healthy range before it's too late.
Hey! Going out like that?
Yeah, why?
Well, what would the neighbors think?
I see you! Come look at Mr. Feather!
Look what I have.
Mr. Bird, remember? Bark, bark, bark! We're just playing! We're just playing! I'm trying to get you out of here!
Even still.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of teens in foster care who don't need perfection. They need you.
Can you help me with this?
My new dad teaches me all kinds of stuff.
Sure.
He helps me with homework.
That would be 3.6795.
Thanks.
Yep.
He helps me with my decision making.
I wouldn't use this one. Ever.
And he's even teaching me how to drive.
And that's why cars have bumpers.
I'm learning so much.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of kids in foster care will take you just as you are.
All right, give me a spot. You know my motto, safety first.
They could be dangerous. I think we should call animal control.
Animal control?
To be safe.
Don't worry. Just... I got this. It's a new motto.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of teens in foster care who don't need perfection. They need you.
You guys are tuned into Boss Lady News, and we are here with Stacy Padula, and I'm just intrigued with the conversation and how you are following your feelings mm-hmm. in reference to where your steps are supposed to go in life. Yeah. And I think that spirituality lead is kind of also what keeps me going with Boss Lady News. So I wanted to take a couple more minutes with you and just talk about how following the tutoring mm-hmm. and continuing with your writing.
You know, it was interesting when I was leaving the architect firm, so many people said, you went to college for 5 years for this. You're crazy to leave to go tutor. And I'm like, God knows me better than I know myself. He knows what's best for me, and he'll take care of me. Mm-hmm. And the career just took off. Within a year and a half, I was promoted to director of the company.
Wow.
And all those people who, you know, I was like, oh my gosh, they're licensed teachers from Harvard. I became their boss.
Yes.
And then I became the developer of all the curriculum. And then I became the one training all the tutors. And, you know, it's just been so fulfilling to know that I prayed, God showed me, I followed it, and I've been so happy. I mean, that was about 8 years ago.
Yes.
And it provided me with wonderful experiences with teens to, you know, further like solidify the messages in my books and make them very relevant to today. And it just all came together in such a fulfilling way.
And being able to do that, you're able, the eye inside of you was able to see that this is an opportunity for you to really follow your desires with your writing also.
Yes.
And getting into doing the writing. So you have these five books here.
Yes.
And where can people order these books, and where can they find out more about you?
There, a couple of the books now are available at Barnes & Noble. They're at Barnes & Noble at the Prudential Center, around the state. I also have a website, which is just stacypadula.com,
mm-hmm.
and they're available on online at Barnes & Noble and also Amazon. So.
That's wonderful. That's awesome.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for coming on.
Oh, thank you for having me.
Yes, great. I'm going to make sure that my one of my boss minions gets one of these books and reads it, because absolutely it's important for the high school going into college to really get some true life experiences through their reading.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. All right. Well, we are going to cut to the clip of Erica Chanel's fashion show, which was the Fame fashion show held at the Boston Common Hotel. Wonderful show, great designers. I know you guys are gonna love it. All right, and we'll be right back. Well, enjoy the show, rather.
I was gonna say, I will give you a sample.
Just a brief snippet.
Okay. Why not? Okay. So I've always just been used to kind of being on the scene and reporting what's going on, and from that background, I was like, you know, hosting would be cool. I'd like to be the one to audiences, just showcasing what's going on and speaking to what's going on and just making them feel comfortable while there. So that's what I try to do every time I host an event. And this is the second fashion show I've hosted. That's a V-Set production. Erica Chanel was also in the first fashion show as a model. So it's just nice to have everything tied back together and to be hosting this again.
Yes. And you really, really did a wonderful job. And at the end, you mentioned how people should really support each other.
Yeah.
How young people, especially entrepreneurs, should be working together. And I think that's very important.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure that message was extremely clear, because, and I didn't know how to word it, but I just felt prompted to say it at the time. And what I said was that we're in a time where we're told, or we're shown that we are of no value. And by we, I mean minorities. And by minorities, I do mean Hispanics and other nationalities and ethnicities that are other than white, but I mean blacks predominantly.
Mm-hmm.
And being that this was an urban show to support urban community, I think it's really important for everyone to understand that supporting each other is key. We keep contributing to our oppressors.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that I said. I don't know if that would have been controversial, but I just needed to get it out there.
And it's that time.
Yeah.
We need to stop worrying about being controversial.
Yeah.
I think there's a variety of white people out there that are ready to have these conversations.
Yep. And who understand.
Yes.
Who understand. I went to a Michael Brown protest a few months back, and it was amazing. The majority of the people there holding up the signs with all the powerful statistics and all the powerful, they were all white.
Mm-hmm.
They were white. So there are people who understand. And then there are those who are afraid and they're like stepping on eggshells when it comes to this conversation. And
mm-hmm.
it's one that needs to happen.
Definitely.
Yeah.
And you being such a gorgeous host can definitely be one to usher in a lot of those conversations throughout events. And I think you did it so wonderfully.
Thank you.
At the fashion show.
I appreciate that. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
And hopefully from that, you know, people come home, go home or in the car, rise up on their way home, they're discussing and they're talking about the last one.
Definitely. And how can people get in touch with you if they'd like to have you for some more of their shows potentially?
Mm-hmm. If you go to Instagram and you type in Liza Escobar with two underscores, not one, but two underscores in between each one, Liza, L-I-Z-A, and then Escobar, you'll find me.
Nice.
And I just want to talk to everyone and be friends with everyone. I'm friendly. I'm a creep in that sense. But, yeah.
Oh, thank you for talking with me.
No problem.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Years ago, your independence wasn't allowed. Only good for cooking and cleaning up the house. Only known for being a housewife wearing gowns. Went from dependent to the most independent girl around. Your discipline with your diligence, I respect that. Equal rights for the sexes, we all accept that. Random guys with her number, she might expect that. But if he's not on this grind, she might reject that. It takes a boss day to boss, baby. Got what it takes, a day to boss, baby. Yeah. Bro, sexy, that's a boss lady. Know how to carry yourself, you a boss lady. Do whatever to succeed, you a boss lady. You gotta practice what you preach, you a boss lady. You gotta get it on your own if you a boss lady. You gotta always hold your own if you a boss lady. Respect you cause you respect yourself. Remain humble and proceed to collect that wealth.